Good evening and welcome to TDM Talk Show. I'm your host, Kelsey Wilhelm. Our guest this evening is Professor Xu Jianhua, the head of the Department of Sociology of the University of Macau, and the author of a recent study on stigma, discrimination, and hate crimes in the Chinese-speaking world amid the COVID-19 pandemic. Thank you for being on the show.
Thank you for having me here.
It's a fascinating study, and it's a very, very relevant topic. So I have to ask you the most obvious question in the world, which is, why did you choose to focus particularly on this topic?
Well, since I'm a sociologist as well as a criminologist, I'm interested in whatever is going on, which is relevant to our daily life. I think the COVID-19 has caused lots of stigma and discrimination, even hate crime against the various population, particularly at the very early stage about the Wuhan people. And we have lots of friends in Wuhan. We have family members in Wuhan. So I think that is something I feel so close to. And that's a real problem. I think I, as a scholar, I can do something about that. Mm-hmm. And I can do my research and help people to know the phenomenon. I think that I feel very much motivated for that study.
Mm-hmm. And it's a very comprehensive study. It took months to put together, and you gathered a lot of different sources of information. Were you surprised with the findings of the study?
Well, I think I'm surprised in some ways, but not in other ways.
Okay.
Generally speaking, the overall research findings, I think progress. Mm-hmm. The more you research on, and then the more findings that you get.
Yeah.
In that sense, you get something surprised.
And
mm-hmm. I'm not, in other ways, I'm not particularly surprised because of all the target population,
yeah.
From the Wuhan people to Hubei people to whole Chinese,
mm-hmm.
to overseas Chinese Asians overseas,
mm-hmm.
and then even back to the Africans in China.
Mm-hmm.
And that, in that sense, because we have been observing that happening in the society, in that sense, we are not surprised.
Mm-hmm.
But in some specific area, I'm a little bit surprised. And in one area we study is about to look at how Hong Kong, Macau, and Taiwan, and overseas media portrayed
mm-hmm.
the disease.
Okay.
We are quite surprised by Macau media.
Yeah.
Because the Macau media were very positive in terms of its relationship with mainland China.
Mm-hmm.
I'll give you one example.
Mm-hmm.
Because before the WHO, we named the disease mm-hmm. into COVID-19. Before that is Wuhan pneumonia.
Yeah.
That is a kind of discriminative connotation.
Mm-hmm.
But after the WHO renamed that, the use of the term Wuhan pneumonia
mm-hmm.
dropped almost to zero in Macau media.
Mm-hmm.
While in Hong Kong media and also in Taiwan media, in overseas Chinese media, it's the still keeping using that term. Even nowadays, today,
mm-hmm, yeah.
1 year, 1.5 year later on, still some media still using that,
mm-hmm.
Like in Hong Kong or in Taiwan.
That's very intriguing. And yeah, we saw the change in the way that the evolution of the virus itself happened, while the naming of the virus also happened.
Right.
I wanted to focus on one of the things which I found very, very interesting, because discrimination started off sort of in one way and then mm. quickly spread, as you mentioned. It started with the people in Wuhan, then Hubei, and then further on. There's one line that was from the study which says, during the COVID-19 outbreak, the source of the infection was over and over again believed from there, not from here,
mm.
from without. And what was without depended in large measure on scale.
Right.
I found that to be fascinating. So if this had been contained within Wuhan and it had not spread,
mm.
do you think that we would have seen such discrimination and such spread of discrimination?
I would suspect, of course, on the one hand, it will not happen because it already spread out,
yeah.
right? But on the other hand, you suppose it could be contained very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
I would say that the discrimination may mainly focus on Wuhan people,
yeah.
but not on other people.
Mm-hmm.
Because if the disease is not an issue anymore, people may not raise that, take that as an issue.
Mm-hmm.
But since nowadays, the pandemic became pandemic,
yeah.
right? And everybody in the globe mm-hmm. were affected, right? And then people always try to find something to blame,
mm-hmm.
some people to blame,
yeah.
right? Because this disease did not originate from my place,
mm-hmm.
come from somewhere,
yeah.
and who should be responsible for that?
Mm-hmm.
They always tended to find some excuse, some scapegoat.
Mm-hmm.
I think that is quite I would say that's not right, but that's quite common. We observe similar cases in human history again and again.
Mm-hmm.
I believe in the future, if similar cases, similar virus or similar pandemic happen, some population will also be stigmatized, discriminated again.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully, after this time, the severity may become a little bit milder, but I suspect history always repeats itself.
Yeah. Fortunately and unfortunately.
Right.
More times unfortunately. Unfortunately. There is an underlying note that you did pick up on and mentioned quite a lot within the study, that there exists already a kind of anti-China or an anti-Chinese sentiment in some of these countries and some of these communities which were discriminating. How much do you think that contributed towards, let's say, lighting the fire of what then became hate crimes?
Right, I think definitely it become a trigger because although the emotion of kind of the tension between China and other countries, between mainland China and Hong Kong, or even Taiwan, and the tension has already been there.
Yeah.
But this kind of virus, COVID-19, become a trigger to revoke, take back, remind people, and it become something which trigger people's another round wave of hate.
Mm-hmm.
I think in many ways is related to the disease, but it's beyond that. Mm-hmm. It's also related to the politics.
Do you think that people still have a stigma against residents of Wuhan in particular?
As far as I know, probably not anymore, because the disease at the very beginning, yes. But nowadays, from my understanding, also from my friends and my research informants, they have been in Wuhan.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think nowadays there's still a particular stigmatization and discrimination and stigma against the Wuhan people anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Because now everywhere, everybody in China, you could be the virus carrier.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody could be. So I don't think nowadays there are still specific target against the Wuhan people.
Mm-hmm.
But at the very beginning, yes.
It's interesting that you mentioned that because within your research also you notice there's a timeline of when the cases outside of China surpassed the cases inside China, and then there was the fear that the cases would begin to be imported.
Right.
And then we saw that. And one of the direct effects was the discrimination against the African community.
Right.
And were you surprised to see that? Because I mean, I remember seeing the images at the time, people sleeping on the streets.
Right.
It was shocking.
Right.
Were you surprised that that happened? And why do you think it was particularly the African community?
Well, I think I'm indeed surprised. Of course, we know the racism exists in all societies, and probably sometimes it tends to be invisible, but in other times when there is an incident, something a trigger that it will emerge again. But I think this COVID-19 and become the kind of a trigger to which I would say bring back Chinese citizens' racism. Of course, there are in some ways they are justified the fear. In some ways, sometimes the fear is over exaggerated.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. So, but of course, sometimes it's harder to distinguish what is the justified fear and what is not.
Yeah.
Right. In terms of the discrimination against the Africans, I would say the racism against the black population in Chinese society, I think, has been there for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
It's not unique and new, but I think this COVID-19 becomes another opportunity to bring back that kind of racism.
Yeah.
So I'm very shocked by the radical action and what we observed from the media about the Africans. Many of them there's no way to hide, there's no way to leave, and they were on the street, and they were evicted by landlords. There's no hotel which can admit them. I'm definitely, I think similar things happened in the modern so-called more civilized society, mm-hmm. I would say, I'm a bit shocked.
Yeah.
I hope
yeah.
that it will never happen again. I don't
me
want
too.
Some similar things happen to me. Mm-hmm. Think of, we are Chinese, when Chinese are discriminated outside in America, in UK, mm-hmm. the Chinese community feel very much outraged.
Mm-hmm.
I think there's a Confucian saying, if you don't treat other people, you won't want to be treated.
Yeah.
Right? 己所不欲，勿施于人. Mm-hmm. You don't treat others like you hope mm-hmm. you will be treated.
Mm-hmm. Right? It's interesting that you mentioned fear, because fear of infection, from what you identified, was only one of the reasons that people would then have a discrimination. And this applied, from what I understood, differently to the different groups of people. So there were different targets and there were different discriminators. Mm. So there were different trigger points for different people.
Right.
And so fear of infection was obviously one which went into all of the categories, all of the various non-Hubei Chinese, Hubei residents, mainland Chinese, overseas Chinese, and Asians, and then Africans in China. But then there was eating wild animals, mask wearing, political ideology. Where did that fall into it? Because it seemed like, obviously looking at statements by someone like Donald Trump, there was a lot of a political game going on
right.
by using this to then try and push that other agendas that
right.
they had.
Right.
How much did that fall, and how much weight do you think that has now?
Well, nowadays, although Donald Trump has stepped down, mm-hmm. Not anymore the president, but I think the kind of the hate, as you can observe, the hate crime mm-hmm. in America is still quite a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure whether it is increasing or not, because of course there are clearly more media coverage
yeah.
about that hate crime.
Yeah.
But of course, more media coverage may not mean more crime,
mm-hmm.
Because the media has its interest.
Mm-hmm.
But on the other hand, we do observe that this hate crime against the Asian community still exists, and also lots of local actions try to protest, try to work out how to prevent such crimes.
Mm-hmm.
So in that sense, we do see the hate crime still incited by the political issues, politics still exist. But on the other hand, we are not sure, although Donald Trump has stepped down, but the hate,
mm-hmm.
the discrimination against the Asian, particularly against the Chinese population, I think is could last much longer than the concrete political figures.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm not sure how long it will last, but usually from the history, certain discrimination and hate crime against the certain population will take off and reach its peak and then tended to fade off.
Okay.
I'm not sure whether or not it has already reached the peak.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have the statistics,
yeah.
but I hope it will not last very long.
Mm-hmm. There's two sides that obviously have a huge influence on that, you know, the use of the political objectives to then encourage more, division between people. You have the government, and then the media plays a huge role. Like you were mentioning, you can't always tell if there's an increase in the number of crimes or if it's just getting reported.
Right.
So in terms of the terminology, you'd mentioned specifically that Macau media had switched quickly to COVID-19 from Wuhan pneumonia.
Right.
How much weight does each one of those have, do you think, in terms of people's daily lives, both the government and the officials in power choosing to use terms like Kung Flu and the media?
Well, I think definitely the media have both politicians and political figures and the media have a huge power in influencing the citizens' opinion.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, if the media tend to be discriminative, and the citizens will definitely be affected by that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So the vice versa. So I think the media really play a very important role in trying to reduce the tension, reduce
mm-hmm.
the
yeah.
discrimination. I think it's. If some media, of course, media have its stance, so they have its mm-hmm. point of view, right?
Yeah.
So I think if a media tend to be more liberal,
mm-hmm.
I think the audience, followers, may be affected by that.
Okay.
If some media are very conservative,
mm-hmm.
I think because we don't have direct interaction with everybody else.
Yeah.
Our information about other population mainly comes from the media.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the people, the deaf people, everybody, people definitely are very heavily, again, influenced by the media.
Mm-hmm.
But the media may also be influenced by the political figures,
yes.
Politicians.
Yes, yes,
I think
yes.
You can see the intertwined interaction
mm-hmm.
between the media and the political figures and the ordinary citizens.
Mm-hmm. I noticed just today that Joe Biden had and his administration had pushed for something called the COVID-19 Hate Crimes Act.
Mm-hmm.
And that included something which I found to be quite interesting. It's guidance to mitigate racially discriminatory language in describing the pandemic. That's something that is done as a government-led initiative.
Mm.
Is that the best way to try and diminish this discrimination and hate crimes? Does it have to come from government or does it have to come from society?
I think both are important. Of course, I think I'm very glad to see Joe Biden's action on that. I think it's very important for the top politicians to have a very clear stance
mm-hmm.
against the hate crime, against the all type of hate crime.
Yeah.
And in this case, particularly against the Asian and the Chinese in particular.
Mm-hmm.
I think I'm very glad to see that. On the other hand, it may take quite a long time for the ordinary citizens, particularly who still have this kind of deep racism,
yeah.
deep against, not sometimes it's racism and also related to the political ideology.
Yeah.
So they combine together, they intertwine together.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it may take much longer than single political statement.
Yeah, that makes sense. Another thing that seems to have contributed to this separation of people has also been, as we were still experiencing
mm.
in Macau to a lesser extent than before, is the border closures.
Mm.
How much do you think that has contributed in some way to discrimination and maybe shifting targets of discrimination?
Mm-hmm. Interesting question. So I think if we look at the border closure across the time,
mm-hmm.
we may understand better about what is discrimination, what is not.
Yeah.
So actually the discrimination itself is also socially constructed.
Mm-hmm.
Think of at the very beginning, when China is the center of an epidemic,
yeah. mm-hmm.
then some countries like Taiwan, like US, mm-hmm. tend to close the border to Chinese citizens.
Mm-hmm.
And the Chinese government protests. That is discrimination.
Mm-hmm.
But from their perspective, that's not. It's mainly because of the disease control.
Yeah.
But then again, when the COVID-19 cases outside of China
mm-hmm.
that started to increase, when China roughly contained its internal cases,
mm-hmm.
and China also shut down its border to outsiders, right? So I think it's you do the same
mm-hmm.
action.
Mm-hmm. And we saw this in country after country.
They right,
were first
right.
protesting, and then they locked down.
Right, right, right. Indeed. So I think it's very hard to say. Probably at the very beginning, nobody have done that. You feel you are discriminated.
Mm-hmm.
But when it's your turn, you do the same. Okay,
mm.
Same. So I think it's very hard to say that is discrimination.
Mm-hmm.
And if we take a longer period perspective, but if we selectively prevent some people from entering while allow other people from entering,
mm-hmm.
that is not purely based on the risk of mm-hmm. Risk of the virus,
yeah.
but based on other issues, probably the political issues that may come into play.
Mm-hmm.
In that sense, I would say there are some element about the discrimination.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not purely about it's very hard to say when you close the board, it's discrimination.
Mm-hmm.
But I think only because of if you use different criteria
yeah.
against the different population, and in that sense, we can say you have discrimination against some population, not towards others.
Okay. Tough question. Macau has a very selective entry policy, which has evolved over time, and we were first very, very closed.
Mm.
Now we're still denying entry to certain populations, mm. certain groups.
Mm-hmm.
We just had Ho Yat Seng the other day talk about if someone has a spouse who is not a Macau resident and
mm.
they can't get into Macau,
mm.
that person should go to visit their spouse and not expect for their spouse to be able to come
mm.
here. Do you think that that could be defined as a form of discrimination in terms of Macau's policies on entry right now?
Well, of course, generally speaking, I think during this pandemic period, the overall, I would say Macau government performance, mm-hmm. I think they are very good, mm-hmm. overall performance. Mm-hmm. I think, of course, there are areas probably the government can do improve, can mm-hmm. do it a little bit better, right? Mm-hmm. I think there are areas. In terms of that, the case that you mentioned, I think probably I'm not, as you said, it's a tough question. I'm not, probably it's mm-hmm. not my stance mm-hmm. to say whether this is clear cut discrimination or not. But mm-hmm. I do think if the government take more consideration against about these people's needs, mm-hmm. and also if resources allowed could do more nuanced, more sophisticated, and the way of control, mm-hmm. While allowing become more humanistic, mm-hmm. and to take people's need into consideration.
Yeah.
But of course, I understand that it's very tough. Yes. It's a very complicated issue. Mm-hmm. If you want to do that, probably you need to spend more resources and more human resources, more money on that. Mm-hmm. And it also depends on about to what extent you really wanted to give resources in that area.
Yeah.
Of course, I would say, by and large, Macau government has done a pretty good job.
Yeah.
But in some particular area, I believe there are space to be improved.
Mm-hmm. And there's so many moving pieces. I mean, we have different variants of the virus which are appearing all over.
Right.
We have, you know, so many different people who have links to Macau, which are spread all over the world.
Right.
So it's not like there's one solution for everything.
Right.
And
right.
I understand that there. We don't even have all the data in hand, so
right.
we're trying to go with as we can.
Right.
There was something you mentioned within the report, which was rooted racism. Mm. Could you just describe that term to me?
Well, rooted racism means something during normal time, probably you don't, there's no opportunity for that to come out.
Mm-hmm.
But from the bottom of your heart, you still have that kind of stereotype against a certain population, certain ethnicity. I think the rooted racism probably exists in most of the people's mind.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes you tend to downplay it.
Yeah.
And then there's no opportunity for that to come out.
Yeah.
And there's no need. And then I think probably you can behave very in a more civilized way,
mm-hmm.
I would say. But given when there is an opportunity,
mm-hmm.
When there's a conflict of interest, which may directly relate to your personal safety,
mm-hmm.
to your personal interest, probably that will come out.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say even I myself, highly better and very well educated person.
Mm-hmm.
I may remind myself. Probably I may also have a certain mm-hmm. rooted racism from the bottom of my heart.
Mm-hmm.
But I think what we can do is try to, you know, remind ourselves. Don't let it out. I think it's just like crime.
Mm-hmm.
You know, many people, we're not saying many crimes are situational.
Mm-hmm.
So don't taste. We always joke. Don't try to test the nature of human being.
Yeah.
You don't provide that opportunity
mm-hmm.
to test the nature of human being.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because many issues, during normal period, most of us can behave in a very reasonable way.
Mm-hmm.
But given certain situation,
probably
people may behave very differently because of that situation, because of tension, because of the difficulty, because of the frustration in that particular period,
mm.
that particular situation. So I think, of course, what we can do in the society of try to minimize that opportunity, mm-hmm. which...
So avoid all pandemics.
Avoid pandemics, that is the best strategy, of course. of course. But I think, because I'm a criminologist,
mm.
and because I also want, of course, we can see this time, the hate crime against the Asian is mainly related to the pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
So let's suppose
mm-hmm.
if there's no pandemic,
there would
be no this COVID-19 related hate crime, right? So the pandemic become a situation.
Yeah.
Right, to provoke, to incite this type of hate crime.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, nobody wants the pandemic, but if that happens, so what we can do is try to, of course, for educated people, we should remind ourselves. Mm. We don't do something against the others which you are not wanted to be treated.
Yeah.
I think for the Chinese, you would bet not against Africans mm-hmm. in China.
Yeah.
And then we can understand the feeling.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Because when the Chinese and over the Chinese are discriminated, they become target of the hate crime. And so what do you feel?
Mm-hmm.
I think that is something we should remind ourselves. And then all of us may become offenders, and mm-hmm. all of us may become the victims.
Yeah.
It depends on the situation.
Yeah, very true, very true. That brings me to one of the lines that I really, really liked from the study. I liked a lot from the study, so.
Thank you.
It says, racism never seems to disappear, but adapts to new circumstance. Mm. The outbreak of the pandemic simply allowed racism and xenophobia to revive.
Mm.
And I think that cuts to the core of that. But it seems like within the different groups that you had, so first when it was focused in Wuhan, then you had, you know, roads being cut off, you had people who were who had Wuhan license plates,
who were not allowed
to stop for gas.
Right.
It was, and then that spread into Hubei, and then that spread into, you know, larger
Chinese society.
Exactly.
Yeah.
As that relates to racism, would you say that when that first part happens, when it's just Wuhan, and people are discriminating against Wuhan, could that be referred to as a type of rooted racism?
No, that's not, of course, because they are from the same race.
Mm-hmm. Right? Yeah.
There is no racism.
Yeah.
But that is from something we call is outsider.
Mm-hmm.
Because for the non-Wuhan people, non-Hubei people, because mm-hmm. because Wuhan and Hubei are at the center of the epidemic, mm-hmm. at the very beginning age, right? At the very early stage.
Mm-hmm.
So when the Wuhan is Hubei is at the center, and the mm-hmm. non-Wuhan, non-Hubei people, they are outsiders.
Mm-hmm.
They tended to discriminate those from Hubei and Wuhan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I think that's because similar things happen again and again in human history, also in Chinese history.
Mm-hmm.
And just let me just remind you one case about the discrimination against the Henanese, mm-hmm. Henan people.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's a quite a long period about discrimination against Henan people, because from the media portrayed, and many Henan people were regarded as criminals.
Okay.
Right, and then there's, I remember there's a slogan put up by Shenzhen police on the street saying, severely crack down on the robbers from Henan.
Okay.
Right, and that's that very
yeah.
large debate about the geographical
mm-hmm.
Discrimination against a certain population.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think that is during normal period, and of course we understand that they are probably in this specific place. There are some people commit a crime, they come from a certain place.
Mm-hmm.
But if when you have a bigger slogan on the street and saying severe crackdown on the people commit crime from Henan.
Yeah.
That became a big issue.
Yeah, they pinpointed it and they've made him a target.
Right, right.
So in terms of looking for blame also, obviously the WHO went into Wuhan mm-hmm. and they investigated and then they published the findings of their report.
Mm.
There were very diverse opinions about the report.
Right.
Do you think that even if there's definitive proof that the virus originated somewhere, that people are still going to find someone else to blame?
Right.
It doesn't seem like this is going away anytime soon. You know, discrimination Chinese, against the Chinese language speakers, overseas Chinese, and then Asians in general, especially from Western society. Mm. Is there any type of end in sight, or is it just human nature?
Well, I think my guess is this could only be ended when the pandemic is over.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, it may go along with the pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
Because of course, they are, as I said, they are also very rooted distrust
mm-hmm.
against the Chinese, I would say it's not about Chinese people, but probably about the Chinese political system
mm-hmm.
Outside of China. I think which became some population, some people, some politicians, they mm-hmm. have kind of tension.
Yeah.
I would say, let's imagine if the original site of the pandemic, mm-hmm. not from China,
mm-hmm.
from another country.
What if it was the United States,
for example? Yes, from the United States.
Mm-hmm. I've thought about that many times.
Yes, yes, I think when people started to blame, say that is the American virus,
mm-hmm.
I would say probably not, at least not at the degree it is now, mm-hmm. against the China. Because that is also a reflection
mm-hmm.
At the political level about the tension. Because I would say, in Western society, there's a long expect about the change of the political system.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully China will move to more toward democracy.
Mm-hmm.
And after so many years of political reform, so many years of this economic reform,
mm-hmm.
hopefully when the economy has been liberalized, mm-hmm. hopefully the political system could also be liberalized.
Mm-hmm.
But clearly after, particularly I think at the beginning of Donald Trump's regime,
mm-hmm.
and the government, the administration, and they tend to think, the Western society, American in particular, kind of has been cheated or by the mm-hmm. Chinese political system.
Mm-hmm.
Also, the economy has become very successful.
Mm-hmm.
It looks the political system become probably even more conservative, if not totally authoritarian.
Mm-hmm.
We do see, I think, in the Western countries, Western media, they do see a return towards more, at least in the recent decade, it's
mm-hmm.
become a little bit more conservative. So I think that is something fundamentally ask for responsibility, ask for the investigation, or the deep distrust.
Mm-hmm.
I think the COVID-19 in this case is just one opportunity
mm-hmm.
to let that distrust continue.
Yeah.
We can see the economical like a war between mm-hmm. China and the United States.
Oh, yeah.
Right? You can
oh, yeah.
see that is already there. So
mm-hmm.
the COVID-19 is the consumption add up to that.
Yeah,
so unfortunately, that is become an issue.
Mm-hmm. And one that's not going to go away. I mean, you saw both in the United States, Republicans and Democrats made that was the one thing that they could bind together on is
right.
focus on China.
Yes, probably one of very few issues that both parties, they can unite
yeah.
and have.
Mm-hmm. And this was one of them, right? unfortunately, I would love to be here all afternoon and talk with you, all evening and talk to you some more. But our time is drawing to a close. This was absolutely fascinating. I would
Thank
highly
you.
Recommend for our viewers to read through it and look at it very seriously
mm.
because it points out a lot of very interesting things and it makes you think about yourself. What other areas are you focusing on? I know that you're doing some other kind of COVID-19-ish related
right.
research. What can you tell us about?
Well, I'm currently working on some project about examining how COVID-19 affected the society at large.
Mm-hmm.
I'm thinking of the post-COVID-19 period, how COVID-19 could affect our social control.
Mm-hmm.
Because we know many social control measures were taking place in the name of COVID-19.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Right? But when we see, even in mainland China, we see in most of the places the COVID-19 become rather stable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Even many places there's no cases,
mm-hmm.
but the heavy control still there.
Mm-hmm.
I would say because all human society, our society in the world are entering into a surveillance society.
Yes.
But also the degree, level of severity may vary.
Mm-hmm.
But China is definitely one of the places which in a very advanced level
mm-hmm.
of
mm-hmm.
surveillance society.
It's very visible also.
Very visible yeah. everywhere. You can mm-hmm. see the CCTV.
Mm-hmm.
Everywhere you can see the access control.
Mm-hmm.
Even unlike the Macau University, you don't have to use the card in
mm-hmm.
order to get to the campus.
Yeah.
But nowadays in mainland China, many places, many universities, they need the facial recognition
mm-hmm.
in order to get into the campus.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's Many, I think, even in the university, in the middle school, in the kindergarten, mm-hmm. you will see the mirrors of social control is increasing, constantly increase. Mm-hmm. And this COVID-19 definitely accelerate that yeah. process of the surveillance regime. Mm-hmm. We say surveillance regime. So I'm interested in looking at how the COVID-19.
Now I'm interested also.
Yeah, how COVID-19 actually has accelerated the development of a surveillance regime. Mm-hmm. And in of course in China, because that is the space, that is the area, the place I'm doing research, but mm-hmm. also in the world, mm-hmm. in the whole world. I'm believing the whole world is developing into a surveillance society. Mm-hmm. So the surveillance world, mm-hmm. Definitely we're not living in a society like 20 years ago, even 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. Many advanced, so-called advanced surveillance technology, nowadays we take it for granted. It's very novel yeah. 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. But yeah. not many issues we feel very uncomfortable today. You may take it very for granted 10 years later. Mm-hmm. So I think as human beings, we are moving towards that human surveillance society. And I'm interested in how the COVID-19 case accelerated that process. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm fascinated to read that. Please continue your research. Yeah. I won't take any more of your time. Thank you so much for being on the show. I really
thank you for having me here. I'm very glad to talk to you on the issue.
And I hope we'll have you back soon.
Thank you very much.
That's all for this week, but join us again next week for more TDM Talk Show. Good night.